Let's get started. So what we would like to solve is the many-body Schrödinger equation. So typically this eigenvalue problem, where psi is an anti-symmetric symmetric function, and this many-body Schrödinger operator is the sum of a one-body operator, where this is the kinetic energy. This is the interaction with the nuclei, and this is the bielectronic interaction. So we have a two-body Hamiltonian. So the usual way to solve such a problem, so if we want to directly solve the many-body problem, would be to resort to some kind of a Galerkin approximation, where we pick a family of orthonormal functions phi I, so one-body function, and then from that we build a basis to the anti-symmetric space of n variables. So this is the Slater determinants, and we expand the wave function in the basis of the Slater determinants with the n functions. So when you do that, of course, well, you hit the curse of dimensions. So quite a lot of possible non-zero coefficients in your expansions, and also it is quite hard to parameterize these coefficients. So, well, of course, there are methods to deal with that, but they are rather elaborate, and it can be tricky to parameterize such coefficients. So another picture that one can adopt is, instead of expanding this wave function into this basis of Slater determinants of n variables, we can try to reparameterize these determinants by looking at which orbital appear in the Slater determinants. So this is what I denote here by these phi brackets mu 1 to mu l. And basically, this phi mu 1 to mu l would be a Slater determinant, where the orbitals phi I k appears if mu k is equal to 1. Okay. So let's just take an example for the moment. So suppose that we have only one-body functions, and we are looking at this Slater determinant, then it will be encoded by 1, because phi 1 appears in the Slater determinant. 0 doesn't, the second, so phi 2 doesn't appear, we have a 0, phi 3 appears, phi 4 appears, so 1, 1, and 0. And these coefficients here then correspond to C1, 3, 4 in this expansion. So so now the advantage is that it's easier to handle such an object. It's just a tensor of 2 to the power l l indices. And just a remark: since we started with the n with a function which is has n particles, then this will be non-zero zero every time that these coefficients, these indices mu 1 mu l, doesn't sum to n. Okay. So yeah. So as I said before, we only have now to handle with a tensor of this dimension, and this we can do using tensor methods. So here, the tensor method that will be of my interest would be matrix product states, or also called tensor trains, and which is at the basis of QCD MRG that you probably heard about. So now we look at what happens to the many-body Hamiltonian. So the many-body Hamiltonian in the occupation number representation will now be 2 to the power L times 2 to the power L matrix. And since we start with an operator which is self-adjoint, the matrix will be symmetric. Okay. It is so a particle number presuming operator because we start with the Hamiltonian, which has acting on the n particle space. So in particular, when you look at the matrix that is representing the Hamiltonian in this occupation number representation, these coefficients will be non-zero if and only if we have the same number of occupied states, or one in mu1, mu l, and mu1, mu l. Now, finally, since we only have a two-body Hamiltonian, we have additional sparsity. If you look at the occupied states, since the interaction is only two-body, in fact, the elements here, they can only be non-zero if these the occupied states only differ by two pairs. Okay. So we are in fact looking at a matrix which is quite sparse. So just to have something in mind. So the operator here will in fact be block diagonal. So this is because the operator is a particle number preserving operator, which acts only in the sectors of the same amount of electrons, and these matrices will have additional sparsity because it's a two body Hamiltonian. So here I present this example, which we will see again later. So for L equal to, we have only a 4x4 matrix, which looks like this. So we have a component which acts on the zero particle sector, which is just of size one. Same here. So this is the two particle sector, and then we have a matrix in the middle which acts on the one particle sector. So just to not go into too many details, because there will be quite a lot when I will speak about matrix product size and matrix product operator. In fact, the right way to represent this operator would be to use its sunken quantization formalism. And the right way to write this huge matrix in 2 to the L times 2 to the L would be to write it in this sum of creation and annihilation operator, where we only have one body terms and two body terms. So now the question will be, how to efficiently represent this operator here using matrix product states? So the equivalent of matrix product states for wave function is matrix product operators when we speak about operators. So just a quick reminder of what is a matrix product state. So if we take a wave function, which is of dimension 2 to the L, then we call its matrix product state representation this representation here. So for each coefficients mu1, mu L, you write it as a product of matrices. So the first matrix here is in fact a row vector. Psi2 of mu2 is a matrix, and so on and so forth, that you multiply until psi l of mu l, which is a column vector. So instead of writing formulas like this, it's easier to handle its graphical representation here. So in this graphical representation, each node represents a tensor. So here I have L equals 4, so I only have four tensors, psi 1 to psi 4. Each open leg represents a variable that you can fix, and each connected leg here means that there is a summation between the shared index. Okay, so here we have a matrix vector multiplication. So we have in particular a summation over the common index that we represent by a disconnected line. And same goes then for psi 2 and psi 3, here and psi 3 and psi 4. So for the matrix product operator, basically we have the same kind of decomposition where we write each coefficient as a sequence of a matrix multiplication. So again, here this is a row vector, and then we have a matrix, and in the end we have a column vector such that we retrieve a scalar in the end. So here, so I will remind this several times. The way that the indices are paired is a bit unusual. So here, this is the column index of my matrix. Here, the mu1 to mu l are my row indices. And the way that they are paired is that we take the first index, the first row index with the first column index. And this has a graphical representation that I put over there. So again, each node is a tensor. H1 is a order three tensor, so it has a three variable, so mu1, mu1, and since we have matrix multiplication, this connected line just denotes the summation over the shared index between H1 and H2. Same then goes for H2. You have two three indices, and then you have a summation between the shared index with H1 and H3, and so on and so forth. finally, for the terminology, the size of the matrices that you have, they have different denominations, but in this talk, I will just stick to ranks. So I will call the size of the matrices ranks. And the same goes for the MPO. For the MPO, I will also call them MPO ranks. Okay. So now I just want to give you a small justification of why we do this kind of weird pairing of the indices. So let's look, for example, at the computation of the expectation value, so phi times h and times psi. So this turns into this formula where we sum over the mu1 mu l and mu1 mu l. And this is where the graphical representation becomes handy. So the way you would compute such a term, if you have the MPS representation of psi and of phi, as well as the MPO representation of h, so the way you would carry such a calculation is that you start with h1, then you sum you sum over the shared index nu1 here, so you would connect the dot here, and the lines here, and the line here then for phi1, so you would have summed these together. So then you would have this leg, up. It's hard to be stable, and this leg open. And you would continue by summing psi two h two phi two, so you would have then this leg open over here, and you would carry on until you have summed all the indices, and you will find the value of your expectation value. And so if you look at what is the cost, the computational cost to carry out such a computation, then it will scale as r, which is the sum over this shared index, and r square because you sum over the shared index between two matrices phi one phi two and psi one psi two. Okay, so when you get provided that the ranks are not too large, you would get a cheap way to compute such quantities. So now to form the MPO representation of the electronic Hamiltonian, we'll see that it is rather easy because you have nice algebraic properties of MPOs. So, for instance, when you take an MPO and that you multiply by a scalar, so this is basically free. You can just add this scalar or try to split this scalar into any of these matrices. Then, for the addition of two MPOs, what you have is that you can write the MPO representation of F in this way. So you for the first MPO matrix, you would just append the first MPO matrix of H as well as the first MPO matrix of H1 tilde. Then for the ones in the middle, you would write them diagonally this way. And for the last one, you would append the last matrices vertically. And so if you, it is straightforward by just expanding this expression that you get indeed an MPO representation of F. So of course, this is not optimal. You could have a better way to represent this, but at least it's one way to obtain a cheap MPO representation of F. And so in particular, then the MPO rank of F would be just the sum of the MPO ranks of H and H tilde. When you go to the multiplication of MPO, you still somewhat have a nice stability result. So as I explained to you earlier, to obtain the MPO representation of G, what you have to do is simply simply sum over the shared indices, and you simply connect the lines here to obtain at least this graphic representation of the operator G, and you can then deduce an MPO representation of G by simply looking at the tensor that is inscribed by these green rectangles. Here you see that the number of indices that link, for example, this rectangle and this rectangle would scale as the MPO rank here times the MPO rank here. So then you would get an MPO representation of G, which is simply the product of the MPO rank of H times the MPO rank of H tilde. So again, this is not optimal, but at least you get an MPO representation of G. So now, what about the operator that we had at the beginning? So to recall, the operator that we had at the beginning can be written using the creation annihilation operator this way. And the nice thing is that the annihilation and creation operators have an MPO representation with rank 1. So this means that when you take, so with the algebraic properties that we have seen before, it means that the one-body operator, so AJ, has an MPO rank 1, and same goes for the two-body part. So now you can just sum everything to get an MPO representation of H, which is relatively sparse, so which have rank which scales as L to the 4. So this is quite nice, but in fact we can do better. So as Markus Barmeyer was telling this morning, in fact you can construct an explicit MPO representation with ranks which is bounded by L squared. So you go from quartic to quadratic. So the goal here would be to reduce this L to the 4 to to L to the square. Or even better, because here we take, this is the general form of an electronic Hamiltonian, but you could, what you could have in your system is some kind of a hidden symmetry that may not be apparent at the beginning, that is not exploited by the explicit MPO representation of H. So you could imagine that you could lower the ranks to something which is better than L square for particular systems that have lots of hidden symmetry. So this is what I will be talking about for the rest of my talk. And so the compression of the MPO. So this is kind of the hardest part, I think. So here I present what is usually called the TTSVD or hierarchical SVD, depending on who is talking about it. So to obtain an MPO representation with the minimal rank, what you do is successive SVD. So for the operator, So for the operator, first you take your operator here, so which is a matrix 2 to the L to the L, and you do first a reordering of the indices. So you pair mu1 with mu1, mu2 with mu2, and so on and so forth. You reshape this reordering into a matrix of size 4 to the L minus 1, and you do an SVD. So this is the matrix of the singular values. And you have V1 here with the rest of the indices mu2 to nu L. And you do another reshape of V1. So you move up this mu2 nu2 to the row index. And you do an SVD of this matrix to obtain, which is here. So this is the SVD of the reshape of V1. And you carry on this procedure with V2. So you reshape V2 to this size. And you continue until you get to L. So when you do that, you obtain this representation for your operator H, and you can read the MPO matrices of the representation of H in these coefficients. So in particular, H1 mu1 mu1 will simply be the coefficient here. Then the shared index would be this alpha 1, and for H2 would simply read the coefficients here, and so on and so forth. Okay. So of course, in this procedure, you are not forced to keep all the singular values. In fact, what you can decide is to throw away some of the singular values during your successive SVDs to only keep the ones that are, let's say, above some threshold epsilon. So just a last remark, because it will be also important later. In fact, this sigma 2, or the sigma k, they are related to a particular reshape of this tensor. So in particular, the sigma k here, they will be related to the reshape where we take mu1, mu1 to μk, μk as a row indices and the rest as column indices. So I will remind this later, but it's just to set up what's next. Okay. So we want to compress the MPO, but at the same time, we want to keep the properties of our MPO. So just to recall, we started with a symmetric matrix, so we would like our compressed MPO to still be symmetric. We had an operator which was a particle number conserving operator, so same goes for the MPO that we want in the end. And ideally, also, we would like to have an operator which have only two-body interactions. But yeah, but this I will maybe mention at the end what happens. So here I have small numerical result. So it's a small system with L equal to 6, I think, or 12. Yeah, well, I don't remember. But basically, what happens is that if you apply the procedure before and you just throw away the singular values without caring too much, but just the ones that are below some threshold, you see that you lose the symmetry of your operator. And the same goes also for the particle number conservation. So when you look at the commutator between your operator and the particle number operator, you see that you have a huge discrepancy. Well, here this is a relatively large tolerances, but for larger systems, you can imagine that you would get something which is more smooth. But the thing is, so this is a solution that was already around and is not too hard to come up. The idea is that instead of throwing everything, when you are doing this truncation, what you should do is to keep the singular values that are degenerate. So when you do that, you obtain these orange points here, which are basically at machine precision. Well, not really, but not too far, at least. So the idea is to see why by keeping these degenerate singular values, you indeed get a representation that preserves the symmetry and also the particle number conservation. So let's start with the symmetry. So we start with the matrix, which is symmetric, and we look. As I told you, we look at a particular reshape of the tensor, and we look at this reshape, which will dictate the behavior of the sigma k, so the singular values of sigma k, as I told you before. And because we are looking at this reshape, the symmetry on the operator turns out to be an equality when you switch all the pairs of indices. Okay, so when you switch mu j with nu j, you happen to find the same value. So when you look at the SVD of this matrix. So here, if you write it by considering all distinct singular values, you get this SVD decomposition of of the reshape of the operator. Same goes with the operator where you switch these indices. But the thing is, these two, they are equal. So by uniqueness of the SVD, this means that these matrices, well, that if you look at kind of the spectral projector, they must satisfy this relationship. So of course, if you are not breaking the degeneracy of the singular values, it means that you keep all these spectral projectors, and it turns out that that you will preserve the symmetry. Okay, so it's not a particular. Well, it's kind of a quick argument to get that. So now let's see what happens for the preservation of the particle number. So for the particle number, it turns out in the end that it will rely on the same argument. So to see that, I think it's easier to just look at what happened on this basic example for L equals 2, so only 4 indices. So you start with the with the this operator here. And as I've already showed you before, so you have this block diagonal structure for your operator. But before doing the SVD, you need to do this this reshape. So you switch mu1 to be a row index and mu2 to be a column index. So while doing that, you shuffle a bit the coefficients to find this this matrix that you take the SVD. And when you look carefully at this this matrix, you realize that in fact, by permuting rows and columns, you have two block diagonal. You have a block diagonal matrix. So the first block will be just these four values, and then the second block would be this one. So then the SVD of this matrix would just turn out to be a tensor product of the SVD of this one. So whatever happens to this one, you don't really care because even if you are truncating, you would keep the structure of this 2x2 block or 2x2 matrix. But when you look at this matrix, the story is not the same. You have zeros that are appearing. So when you are doing the SVD and truncating the SVD of this block, you need to keep the zero over here to retrieve an operator, which is a particle number preserving operator. And what is kind of neat is that you realize that because the operator here is symmetric, these coefficients are equal. And basically, by solving the problem of the symmetry, you are also solving at the same time the problem of the particle number conservation. So when you generalize this to larger operators, you see that by not breaking the degeneracy of the singular values, you indeed preserve the particle number conservation. So yeah, with the time remaining, I will just speak about the sparse representation of the MPO. So so this part is also quite preliminary. So yeah, so may not be so super clear. Let's see. So to understand why MPO, well, the MPO representation of Hamiltonian, which is particle number preserving and that have only two-body interaction, can, well, if the MPO representation of such operator can be sparse, you can, well, we will start with why the MPS representation of an n particle state is in fact sparse. So this is not really new. This is something that was explained already in the talk. Well, it was mentioned in the talk this morning, but it is explained in the paper by Barmeyer and the co-workers. But here, it is written, let's say, in our own words. So you consider psi a state which is an n-particle state. So this means that if you look at when these coefficients are non-zero, they can only be non-zero when the number of occupied states is exactly n. Okay. So this, in fact, has a huge impact when you look at the MPS representation of this state. Why? So to get an MPS representation, you do these successive SVDs. And you realize that because of this constraint, basically, when you are looking at this reshape, so mu1 is this row index, and these on top are the column index, so it's a 2 by 2 to the L minus 1 matrix, you realize that the singular value decomposition of this matrix is a block diagonal, in fact. So this is because this row here has index mu1 equals to 0, so it can only be paired to indices mu2 to mu l, which sum to n. And same goes then for the second row. For the second row, you have mu1 equals to 1, So it can only be paired with indices that sum to n minus 1. So that's why you have block diagonal SVD decomposition. And so for the first MPS core, you read the row vector here and here, and you see that they have some sparsity. So now becomes the trickier part, which is looking at what happens next. So for the second SVD, let's say that we take this one, doesn't really matter. So you take this matrix, and you'd first do a reshape, okay? So you moved mu2, which was a column index, as a row index, to have this matrix. And then you perform an SVD. And with the same arguments as before, you realize that this has also a block diagonal SVD, because the same argument that was true before also applies. This here only is paired with indices that sum to zero, so it can only be paired with indices that sum to n. Then for this block over here, this is paired with indices that sum to one, and so it can only be paired with indices that sum to n minus one. And same goes for the last block. So that's why you have an SVD which is again a block diagonal. And when you look at what is then the MPS core or the MPS matrices of the second MPS matrices representing psi, you read it by picking the one that have in the index mu2 equals 0 and mu2 equals 1. So for 0, it would be this one and this one over here. You see that you have this sparsity pattern. The psi2 having index 0 will be a block diagonal, and the one with the index 1 will be upper diagonal. So this is basically what is written in Marcus Barmeyer paper. You can find an MPS representation which has this sparsity pattern, with only block diagonal matrix on the diagonal for zero and on the upper diagonal there. So one tricky part is in fact you only have n matrices in this block diagonal form. It's because you can only pair indices that sum to n. Okay, so it makes sense that it goes up to n. And here, since you have an occupied state at k, you can only pair n minus one states. N minus one states afterwards. So that's why it goes only to n minus one here. So what is the relation then with the block MPO structure? And this will be then the end of the talk. So the relationship with the MPO structure. So as I told you before, doing an MPO of this matrix is the same as doing an MPS representation of such tensor, where you consider mu1, mu1 as a common index, mu2, mu2 to be a common index, and so on and so forth. And the particle number preserving property turns out can be written this way. So you can only have the same number of occupied states for mu k and nu k. And when you look carefully at what are the values of mu k and mu minus nu k, this can only take value minus 1, 0, and 1. So this is kind of like, so if I may go back, this is kind of like an MPS, where in fact, where instead of having 0 and 1, you get minus 1, 0, and 1, and you sum, in fact, to 0. Okay. So this is basically the similarity. And if you do the MPS decomposition, basically what you realize is that if you take an MPO that is representing a particle number preserving operator, then you get matrices that are either diagonal or lower diagonal. And finally, since we start with the two-body Hamiltonian, the thing is, you don't have so many of these matrices in the diagonal, because basically you can only have pairings you can only have two different pairings of indices mu and nu, and so this limits, in fact, the number of block diagonal matrices that are non-zero. And what is nice is, yeah, it doesn't depend on the number of sites that you have. It's kind of a small amount of matrices that you have to deal. So that is basically the result. If you take H, an operator which is a two-body Hamiltonian and that is a particle number preserving, then its MPO representation can be reduced to these matrices over there. So to conclude, if you do an MPO truncation by not breaking the degeneracy of the singular values, what you obtain is that an MPO representation which is Hermitian and which is also a particle number preserving, and what I have also showed in the second part of the talk, or the last part of the talk actually. You can get a sparse MPO representation of this two-body Hamiltonian by doing this connection with the sparse MPS structure. So it's something that I have not mentioned at the beginning, but it's a very preliminary work. So basically, this is something that we realized not so long ago, and the idea would then to be to implement these findings. To exploit, to code up a DMRG code which exploits the sparse cross structure of the MPO and the MPS, and to have everything which runs fast. So with that, I would like to thank you for your attention, and I'll be happy to take questions.